This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Coming to Northeast Wisconsin live from the Civic Media Studios and featuring TV and radio broadcast veteran John Mino, along with the City of Green Bay's longest serving mayor, Jim Schmidt. This is Mino and the Mayor. Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive. And here are your hosts, John Mino and Jim Schmidt.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome back, Mino the Mayor, here at 97.9 FM. WGBW 98.3 FM WSS, and of course worldwide on the Civic Media app. I got some texts here. Let's put it this way that Mino could understand possibly. There is a scene in Serial Mom where Kathleen Turner's character is sorting her recyclables. They're all clean and organized.
There you go. See?
Another one, it's a rule to wash out your recycling.
I don't, is it a rule? Is it a law? I know that they suggested on that blue card that they give you that you didn't read.
I never saw one. It looks like Mino needs to pay more like $50 an hour if somebody cleans his apartment. If somebody will clean my apartment, I will give you $50. Right now, anybody listening, I will give you $50 to clean my apartment. And I got another text here. I can't stomach dookies. Put that on a t-shirt, Jim.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Telling you.
Chris, your son or daughter.
Sparky.
Had a, got accepted, applied to two schools, St. Norbert and Duke. And they got accepted to both. And finances being kind of equal within $5,000, what would you do?
I would send him to St. Norbert.
Thank
because
you.
It's closer.
Bill.
It's local.
Bill.
And you'd be able to visit
Bill.
More often, unless you don't like your kids, and send them to Duke.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sparky. My man, right, Spark, right, here. Right, Chris, I can never pronounce your last name, Sparky.
It is Nejedlo.
Nejedlo. You do pronounce the J.
Yeah.
That seems weird for a Czech name.
Yeah. Telemarketers have a real good time with it.
I'll bet. Chris Nejedlo. Licensed electrician. He's so busy, it's mind-boggling. And, you know, I actually, this is no lie, Jim. I actually thought about being an electrician when I was in high school.
Huh.
But I couldn't figure it out. I couldn't understand where electricity, like, came from.
Right. How does that work?
How does that work? But I actually thought about doing that. But anyway, Sparky is here. We want to talk about something. We have our guys who actually have the fire chief from Hobart, or excuse me, from Howard.
Howard Hobart.
Howard Hobart.
No, it is, you're right. It was Howard Swamico.
Howard Swamico. And then... who else do we have on talking about?
Right.
Oh, from Midwest Restoration,
right?
Where they go and clean up fires. And the reason I wanted to have you on, like, the Randall Cobb, former Packer, his garage, like, burnt down or whatever from a lithium battery. Sparky, what's going on with these things?
As far as a Tesla charger, there are so many variables that could cause it to start on fire, like if the wrong size wire is pulled through it or its circuit isn't big enough to handle it. If it is wired correctly, sometimes just the loose wire on the actual receptacle will cause a fire because they say loose wires cause fires.
That's scary.
It is.
That's a good little rhyme.
Yep.
I like that.
Stop, drop, and roll.
Yeah.
Loose fires.
Did you ever have to do that?
Oh, yeah.
I did, too.
No, I think our kids did that. No, I don't think
I got caught on fire one time. I had to do that.
Ooh.
No, did you practice?
True story.
But did you practice that in school? Our kids practiced that in school.
I dropped and rolled in the snowbank. Burning garbage. We all used to burn our own garbage, okay, back in the day. And that was one of my jobs, and I loved it, burning the garbage. And I had you had the stick to stir everything up, so whatever. And I was leaning on it, kind of, and I wore those big, like, puffy jackets that we all used to have. And all of a sudden, it's like, wow, this garbage is smelling bad. And I realized my whole jacket was melting. The whole side was up.
That would
do it. And I dropped and rolled.
That
paid off.
That just paid off, all that training. That's good. Good for you.
Yeah.
First with Tesla.
Twice I had to do it. The other time when I was trying to make napalm, remember I told you that story? With ivory soap and gas?
You may have.
Then I got burnt really
listen.
Bad. No? Okay. But anyway. Hey, Spark.
Wow. Why did you say Tesla? That happens in more than that?
I mean, but basically it could be any charger, but and actually any charger, if the wires are loose, if they're not torqued down enough, it'll start a fire because it basically charges for like six hours a night. I think it's like a continuous load.
Oh.
So it's not like you just plug it in and 10 minutes later it's done. It's actually charging all night.
I just saw that Tesla's stock went up quite a bit because of the election. Because you know he's.
I would have thought it would have gone the other way.
Are you kidding? He's in bed with Trump. What?
Oh, I thought that was the electric cars. Tesla?
No. No, two things, right? I mean, we're talking about Elon Musk, who owns Tesla. So that I think he's going to get what he wants. I will tell you that electric car thing, which is kind of interesting, and he's making a good point and doesn't know it. There's a lot of incentives for the EV. And
you're talking about me or Trump?
me. They're going to take away those incentives, the $7,000 and all that. I think those are going to go away. So I don't think there's going to be as much EV as President Biden wanted. But I do think Tesla's going to do well because of his relationship with our new president. I don't know. I don't want to talk politics. But
as an electrician.
What do you think?
Well, I think if you want a Tesla, you're going to buy one. I mean, you don't want to be really forced to do it. So, I mean,
right.
If you want it, you're going to buy it. And I've driven one, and they're a lot of fun. They go very fast, very quick.
Oh. Well, let me ask this though, Sparky. I mean, this is weird. I mean, even like when we had the guys in for Midwest Restoration, and they obviously have to, you know, they never go on a call that's a good call. It's always, you know, mm-hmm. something bad. But I like even like a leaf blower or a weed trimmer with those batteries, they said there are fires from those. That's a scary thing. We've all got a leaf blower or something plugged into our garage.
Yeah, I have personally the power tool that uses at DeWalt, and you hear of those battery chargers starting on fire as well. So I try, and if I'm charging something, I make sure I keep an eye on it or I don't leave it in my shop unattended overnight. You just, you know, to be smart with it.
Wow. I mean, that's scary, isn't it?
Right. And I don't even know why they start on fire. I don't know what the cause is, but I try to be mentally acute just to make sure that I keep tended.
But then last week or a couple weeks ago, we were in Oshkosh and doing a thing, and we had a guy from the fire department there and everything.
Right.
And there was, in a recycling truck, somebody had thrown away a battery.
Right.
And remember, that got caught fire.
At the dump, it was quite a...
Yeah, it's possible maybe the terminal shorted out, maybe touching something metal or the side of the truck or something. You know, that's probably maybe why that happened. It probably just shorted out.
Yeah, so
that's scary.
You're obviously a licensed electrician. People are allowed to do their own electrical work in their house, right? As long as they own it.
Well, in some municipalities, some do not. I think the city of Green Bay does let you do it.
Yeah, we do it in Green Bay. I didn't know that. I thought that was more.
Even by code and everything?
Yeah, not every municipality will allow
only your house.
Yep, exactly.
Oh, I didn't know that.
But not every municipality.
So different place or different.
Yeah.
Because like some guy who, you know, I know how to wire a yada, yada, yada.
that's what I think. I don't know that that's the best.
Yeah.
Ordinance.
I'm not sure I'd want to buy a house if there wasn't
I've seen a lot of people wire the YouTube wirers. You know, they look on YouTube and it's like they show you exactly how to do it. But my premise is that anybody can wire a house. Some people do have the skills, but do they know the code? There's so many codes. I could have brought my code book. It's an inch thick, a legal document, and there are so many codes that you have to follow. And a lot of people don't know that part of it.
Wow.
You're successful as an electrician. Have you thought about going to the government and being an inspector, electrical inspector? Because we have some of those guys are drilled in all three, right? Building, electrical, plumbing. But there's other people that just pick a lane.
Yeah, I've definitely thought about it, but I don't like being hated by people. So,
and they are. Aren't they?
They are not.
The thing is, get there early. You know, you guys go in there after and have a pull it off.
Okay, but let's be honest, Jim. We've both dealt with them in real estate or whatever. Some just come in with an attitude.
Yeah.
Let's be honest.
Yeah, there's some really good inspectors out there, and there's some that are just, they can be.
Yeah.
Right.
But the one thing about it is if they know your skills, or they've seen your work, and they know that you do good work.
You're credible.
It goes a lot better.
Yeah.
And I think there's going to be, well, it depends. You know, we just had an election 2 days ago, but it appears that the housing costs are a lot because of supply and demand. There just aren't enough houses. I mean, some people said, well, let's give everybody $25,000 to help buy a house. But it's really an inventory problem more than it is a price problem. And the new guy coming in is going to really take some federal regulations away to let people build faster. So do you do a lot of electrical for new housing or for redoing, or how does it? Because I think there's going to be a big market for you guys.
Yeah, personally by myself, I have one contractor I work with that builds houses, but he hasn't been doing a lot.
No, nobody has.
Nope. So me for its remodels, service upgrades, stuff like that.
But, Are DIY people like your biggest, I don't want to say nightmare, but it's like where you kind of scratch your head and you try to be nice and...
I've seen some things, things that keep me awake at night. It's like, how did this house not burn down?
Right.
Especially with the home inspections. I get called in and I'm looking at this stuff and it's like, oh my goodness. How did this not burn down?
And another thing though, too, and we're talking when we have a Ben and Deanna Malcor on from Berkshire Hathaway Realty. And we talk about that and with inspections and all those different things. And something like with you guys, when you come in and you look at some of these places, and the people did it themselves, and it's like, I mean, a lot of people now, I mean, well, maybe it's eased up a little bit with the thing, but a lot of people were forgoing any sort of inspection, and it's right. Like, man, I'd have a hard time with my family sleeping in a new house I just bought if it wasn't inspected by a professional like yourself.
Yeah, I've run into that a lot where it's like, they'll come in to troubleshoot something, and it's like, did you have an inspection when you bought this? No, we didn't.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Wow. Would you ever have your family move into a house that wasn't inspected?
Oh, never.
Never.
Nope.
With the electrical, what's the biggest thing that you're finding right now? Is it that the older houses that it needs to be upgraded? Is it that it's been done wrong? Or, you know, I mean, God forbid there's fires, but we're talking about where they start and most of them in the kitchen. I mean, yeah. Right? Let's just, yeah. Just all agree to that. But after that, you know, there could be an electrical issue. What should people look for?
Basically, the electrical panel is where it all starts. And if there's like a small panel and a lot of wires going into it, that's usually a sign maybe you need to upgrade the panel just to make sure you can split up circuits and, you know, so you do not have fires.
What about like Jim's neighborhood, beautiful houses. Oh, they're all 100 and some years old. Oh, yeah. But it was like, was it tube?
Knob and tube.
Mm-hmm. Well, when you go into a house like that, yeah. Is this beautiful, aesthetically gorgeous yeah. house, and you get into the bowels of it, what do you find?
I usually run away when I see knob and tube.
Right.
But I've been in several projects where I've corrected, and I really feel good about it because it's gone. It's got brand new wiring in it. They're going to be safe. Life yeah. is good.
We still kept the knob and tube in there. We got the new wiring. It looks cool.
Yeah.
And oh,
yeah.
The kids are like, what is that? Yeah. But yeah, that was really, I don't know, when you guys switched over.
If you ever get it, can you give them to me? Because I use those for my birdhouses. I put those on as part of the ledge for the birds. I'm not even joking about this. On my Barnwood birdhouses, I love using the tubes on the birdhouses. The white ceramic.
Oh, yeah.
I love those.
They're those are insulators, right?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Thank
so you got the,
wow, check
yeah.
out the big brain. Very good. Todd.
That's interesting.
I may have burned down a house or two.
There you go. All
right. We got my man Sparky, Chris Nagello, licensed electrician, talking about this. And again, I want to talk about the Randall Cobb thing. His garage burned down because yeah. of his car.
Yeah.
Back after this.
You feel all right when you hear the music. Step inside, but you don't see too many faces. Coming in out of the rain and hear the jazz go down.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Sultans, yeah, the Sultans play Creole.
Hey, welcome back. Mind of the Mayor here on 97.9 FM WGBW, 98.3 FM WSS, of course, the Civic Media. We're with Chris Nagelata. We just call him Sparky, licensed electrician, guru on all things electric. And we're just talking about that, Sparky, a little bit. We talked about Randall Cobb's car burned or got caught on fire and the garage burned down or whatever. And we talked about with our boys from Midwest Restoration where some of the things they go to, it's like, you know, back when, was it Benjamin Franklin the first discovered electricity?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, back to those days and like not much change for like 100 or 200 years. And now things are really changing, aren't they?
Yeah. There's, I mean, every year or the code recycles every 3 years. And the National Electrical Code, and they come up with brand new ways to make things safe. Unfortunately, it's brand new ways to make things more expensive as far as sure. wiring a house.
Wow.
How expensive is it these days for an electric? I'm not going to ask you how much you make an hour. You said you started at, what, $6.50 an hour?
Yeah, when I back 100 years ago.
And it's gone up yeah. since then or no?
A little bit.
Because I want to hire for some stuff. I'll pay you six. I'll pay you $7. What do you think, Jim? Did you get your house? I mean, your house is what, 100 and how many years? How old is your house?
120.
Yeah.
So did you have to get it rewired when you bought it, or had it been?
No. The guy before me, because some of those houses were getting a little going to go one way or another. And the guy who had it before me did a lot of that infrastructure. I did some more exterior things, but it was all done. The plumbing, and you have to do that. And especially, you know, you said now the houses are built. You know, pretty, you said the standards are much, much higher.
Quite a bit higher.
Well, but, you know, I got to be honest with you, though. So one of my dreams, and this is going to be one thing I'm going to do. This is one of my dreams and goals that will actually happen. I'm going to move to Northern Italy, where you can buy these houses for like $100. Okay. So I've been
Let them.
So I've been watching this show about that. These people go, but what they're finding is some of the, some things aren't really up to snuff, like the electricians took some shortcuts, and the Southern Italian guy with the plumbing didn't quite do it, yada, yada, yada. So I'm a little concerned. So I might have you come to Italy to rewire my house.
Travel charge might be a bit high.
Right.
But
$7.
I'd be more than happy. Well.
$7 an hour, Sparky. $7 an hour. So with these people, you know, a lot of times, obviously we had the big flipping thing a few years ago, and Ben and Deanna would come. I don't know if there's houses that you can buy anymore to flip. But a lot of those people, and I'm not going to name names, but I know they took shortcuts at times. How much of that have you seen in your career?
Oh, I've definitely seen that. You can usually tell, you know, the house look all beautiful, you know, the paint and the trim and everything's so beautiful. But you get to the wiring and it's like they didn't have a professional come in. They did it themselves as well.
And it wasn't illegal, because it's not, but the inspection wasn't done. That's
right. Yeah, they probably didn't have any inspections.
That's what it was. And there you have to have it. You should have it inspected. Go take a permit. People don't do that.
It was probably dark outside when they were doing the work. So.
Of all the things, your house can burn down while you're sleeping. Right. How would you shortcut that?
Right. Can we talk maybe smoke detectors? Because we have the thing about changing the batteries.
Right.
Yeah. The new codes, well, actually, since the mid-90s, you have to have a smoke alarm inside every bedroom, outside every group of bedrooms. You have to have a CO detector on each level. So that is something that's one of the safety things that they've come up with, which is a good thing.
Would you recommend hardwired or battery?
Hardwired. In any new construction, it's got to be hardwired with battery backup.
Wow, okay.
And I didn't know the CO2, is that what it is? The
carbon monoxide.
On every floor.
Yep.
So I got that now. I'm renting my house out for the NFL draft, and they came through, and they're like, oh, you need this on every floor. And I'm like, wow, I didn't know that.
And what did you say, outside of every bedroom?
Yeah, so basically inside every bedroom. So they're thinking if that bedroom door is shut and there's a fire, you have that smoke alarm inside the bedroom that's going to go off if there's a fire, you know, a fire in a different part of the house.
Okay, I didn't know that. Did you?
No, that's a lot of smoke detectors.
It is. Oh, and those add up, too. I mean, the CO detectors are $50-$60.
But if you can buy the combination.
Yes.
Those are awesome.
Yep.
Really, every bedroom has to have it inside the bedroom?
Yep.
Is that, but they don't go back on that. I mean, that's grandfathered in, right?
Exactly. Yes. So.
Well, those aren't the prettiest things either. I mean, it's too bad they're not more decorative.
Right. Yeah, you just kind of hide them where you can.
That's true. Yeah.
I mean, really, it's just...
Looks pretty industrial.
Yeah.
And they get a little... Of course he would say that.
Well, no,
I don't have any because they don't look aesthetically.
Well, we don't...
They don't fit in.
Well, they don't. We don't even have cold air returns. We don't have air conditioning because it's, you know, those homes are... They're
Todd's dying over there.
I know. Whatever. Okay.
Well, we don't want the linens to go up in flames.
Oh, that's funny. All right. Okay, okay.
Thank you for listening, Sparky.
Yes, thanks for being a listener.
Thank you for listening. Yes.
All right.
Give me advice, Jim, for somebody that's going to be looking at a house. And again, unfortunately, in order to get some of these houses, you got to just bare minimum as far as the inspections and things like that. If somebody goes to look at a house and they're thinking about buying, give us some red flags for these people to at least notice with their own eyeballs if there isn't an inspector.
This may sound funny, but if you see a crooked outlet, that means that maybe it's not quality work. I mean, you know, I spend time to make sure everything's level and good. Like I said, the electrical panel, if there's like a million wires going into it and it's only like a 20 space or something, there may be an issue. So
I think that's really interesting to say that if the outlets are crooked, it's like, this guy might have done it himself this lady. Yeah.
Generally, good electricians leave it, you know, everything nice.
Right.
Okay, let me ask you, because I've seen this in houses where sometimes, okay, you got the ground, you know, the little thing for the ground. sometimes it's up on top and sometimes it's on the bottom. Is there a reason for that?
Oh, the plugs themselves? Yes. There's a big debate in the electrical forums about that. Mainly the commercial guys, it's upside down, which kind of makes sense because if it's, you know, the way we normally see them and there's a metal plate or something, you unscrew that metal plate and the plug, if something's plugged in, you know, that plate could come down and make contact with those two prongs, which would cause real excitement. But that rarely happens.
But so, that's the reason, huh?
Well, yeah, it's a debate.
Well, I've always wondered about that. Yeah. Why sometimes you'll see them one way and sometimes the other way.
Hospitals, you'll see them upside. I call it upside down.
Because of sparks? They don't want sparks?
Yeah, apparently. I mean, there's no code that says it's got to be one way or another. It's just maybe commercial guys versus residential guys.
I'll be darned. Yeah. Well, that just answered my question.
There you go.
Oh, interesting. Sparky, my man.
So in terms of people wanting to look at a field that are maybe 20-year-old kid or 18 out of school that has an interest in electrical, what did you do? How did you get your degree?
Basically, I went to NWTC, got my vocational degree. A good math background is important. Troubleshooting, mechanical ability.
Okay.
Those are the things that you should probably have before you enter the
field. Other than those two things, I could do what you do.
Right.
Other than those two things.
Three.
Sparky, do you need help? You need
assistance? Well, John, I'll have you. There's some attic work I got coming up, so. Yep.
Cleaning out the attic.
I got to be honest with you. I look hot in a tool belt.
I did not need to know that.
Women have told me that. Women have told me that. Sparky, you're great, man. Thanks for what you do.
No problem.
Back at us. Under pressure.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Mino and the Mayor with you anywhere. Download the Civic Media app today from the Apple Store or Google Play Store. And text the studio directly, all from the Civic Media app. Download it today. Now, once again, here's Mino and the Mayor, John Mino and Jim Schmidt.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome back. Mino and the Mayor here. Thank you to Sparky Krishnajindlu. Talking to us about the great things going on in the world of you know what? You ever think about this? You ever wish you could have like two or three different lives? Like, okay, I'm at the end of this one. Now I'm going to go back and I'm going to do something else.
Always.
I think about it all the time. I'd be an electrician.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that. But yeah, it's all of a sudden you realize like, holy mackerel, that's
but he
it.
Said, you know, math, right? Not good with
that. Yeah, let me just say this.
I didn't say I was going to be a good electrician.
Yeah. You got to be licensed.
All right, Todd, introduce our next special guest.
Well, you know, some big changes in Oshkosh. The Oshkosh Arena is under new management, and Maria Turner, who's the marketing and sales manager there, and Andy Linton, who is the executive director of the Oshkosh Arena, are joining us from our Oshkosh studios at WISS. Right. To tell us a little bit about their plans to, I want to say, revitalize that location.
You have a beautiful facility. And
We drove by it the other morning at 5 in the morning or whatever. Well, actually, it was after 6 because we got lost or whatever because there's no directions, whatever.
No,
but it was just beautiful the way it was lit up. Remember, Jim, we even said that.
Yeah, that's a great-looking facility. And you can have the nicest facility, but if you don't have the right management, that could be an empty facility. And I'm so glad they brought you guys on board because we've been fortunate here in Green Bay. We've got some good facilities, and a couple of them are managed really, really well. Another one could use a little better management, but... how are you going to make it work?
And good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Yes. You know, our venue works, we bring content to building, and that's what we thrive to do in all our buildings. We're looking to, you know, bring different acts, different shows, not just be the herd, you know, home of the herd.
Right. So, that diversity is what people want. And, you know, I think a lot of people like basketball, but not everyone loves basketball. So, I mean, to reach out a little bit. Do you manage
the layout is perfect.
Oh, yeah, it is. But, yeah. What else do you guys do in terms of you manage other properties, right?
Yeah, Venue Works handles all kinds of projects, properties that are about this size, 4 to 6,000 seat arenas. They also do a lot of convention centers. We're real big into amphitheaters and theaters themselves. We have about 40 plus buildings across the United States now,
between
Washington to Virginia, from as far north as Oshkosh all the way down to Alabama. So,
are you from Alabama?
Well, I'm originally from West Virginia, but that's where I came from, is Alabama. Been down in Alabama for the last 3 or 4 years, and it's going to be a pretty good climate change adjustment for me. So,
okay, I got to say this, though. You're the only person I've talked to from, when I asked where they're from, if they're from West Virginia, they didn't say, I'm from West by God, Virginia. True?
Yeah, well, that kind of rubbed off after 17 years in Kentucky and then moving down to Alabama. So, you know, West Virginia will always be my home state. That's where I was born and raised.
So, Maria, what about the marketing of these? I think people might think you're basketball, and you want to be more than basketball.
Yeah, absolutely. I know that, you know, the community is thinking about the upcoming herd season, which kicks off next Friday. So we're very excited about that. But the arena has so much potential just to do all kinds of different events, everything from concerts, which we're really excited about. We've had a history under the previous ownership of having some great concerts coming into that space. And we're really looking forward to doing even better with the connections that VenueWorks has with various promoters throughout the country. And then, you know, we're looking at other things, community projects. So the Oshkosh Indoor Farmers Market kicks off in our space this coming Saturday.
Great.
That will be from 9 until 12:30. We have over 50 vendors, local vendors from Oshkosh and the Fox Cities and beyond, you know, and they're very excited to come into the space and show the community everything that they have to offer as well.
Those indoor farmers markets, it almost becomes like a more of a, not networking, but it's just, it's free, right, to get in there and walk around?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
And that's just great to get people out. Yeah, we have, that's really a good idea. All right. Cool.
Absolutely. Family friendly type of thing as well, right? I mean, we're very much behind wanting to have families utilize our space. And then, you know, private parties, things that you would think about for class reunions or birthday parties, you know, things like that. We have space available to do that on some of our party duck areas and our VIP lounge. So really, it runs the gamut when you're asking, what do we want to do? Business convections, all kinds of things. Whatever people can imagine, we think that we can offer a really great space for them to do so.
We, Jim and I, are big fans of Oshkosh. And we're not just saying that, not blowing smoke or anything like that. We like what Oshkosh does. And, of course, we're on WISS and Oshkosh. But what I love about that arena, and I fill in sometimes with Ted Stefaniak to do the herd games, I just love the layout of that place where you have the one section on the kind of like the loft, the balcony type thing. Then you got what's called the VIP room, but it's just a bar that's next to it. Whoever designed that did it right. And it wasn't just for basketball games. And like you said, multi-purpose type of arena, and it's not so huge that you get lost in the space. No BS. I've been to a million arenas in my life doing sports. I really like whoever designed that arena.
Yeah, they really designed the arena very well. And it's got everything we need to do shows. I mean, it's not, they spared no expense.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you, Andy, because if you managing 40 other venues, what attracted you to the herd, or what do you call that? What is the place called?
Oshkosh Arena.
Oshkosh Arena. Oshkosh. What attracted you to that? You kind of answered that. You think they've got everything you need to expand the product offering?
About September, I was called and asked to come up and take a look at it. I always told them I wasn't going to come north, but it was too far. I said, I'm not going to go above Mason-Dixon line. And then he called me and just said, hey, I need you to go up and analyze the building. So when I came up and analyzed the building, was looking around, I spent 4 days here in Oshkosh, did a lot of talking to people as I was out and about, and everybody supports this building. And the community vibe that I got from this town was just amazing. Plus the beautiful lake. I mean, Lake Winnebago is awesome. And my wife fell in love with it, and we talked about it, discussed it. So I said, let's go. So here I am.
Well, kudos to Oshkosh. I mean, right? You picked it not just because of the facility, because of the community.
It's the community. Absolutely the community. I love where I live here now. I moved here. I live over, you know, about 3 miles down the road. Uh-huh. I love the area. It's great. You know, the EAA, we was up here when that happened, and you know, just to see the amount of people that come here just for that air show was just, it blew my mind. So, I mean, I think that we can definitely create a real good vibe here at the Oshkosh Arena. We got a lot of events that we're looking at. You know, it's kind of hard to get a train moving, but we're going to,
right.
We came in late in the season, but we'll start getting this thing rolling and start booking the building.
Well, you guys, and we were in Oshkosh in the summer, and we went around to all the different places and everything like that. And we're talking to the gentleman, Pat, that, you know, pretty much
Discover Wisconsin.
Discover Wisconsin.
Discover Oshkosh.
Discover Oshkosh, rather, yeah. And he said, you know, there had been some issues with management, not to get into the weeds of that, but this beautiful facility, a phenomenal organization with the Milwaukee Bucks, it's like you got a lot of really great things. There was just kind of like one missing link, some really diehard professionals to grab it by the reins and say, okay, here's what we're going to do. And it's very cool that you guys have filled that spot.
Well, appreciate it, and we thank you. I mean, we're gonna focus on, you know, good quality food, good quality shows, and, you know, the experience, because at the end of the day, that's what everybody wants, is a good experience.
Well, for basketball fans, so I mean, we got two things going here in Wisconsin, in Northeast Wisconsin, that are, and I've done sports for, you know, years and years and years, but this is so cool that you got future Milwaukee Brewers living and playing in Appleton. And you got future Milwaukee Bucks or wherever they may go playing in Oshkosh. This is really cool, especially bring out kids. You get to see the future. I remember that one Brewers playoff game, and it's like of the three home runs, they were all hit by two guys that used to play in Appleton. And we got Milwaukee Bucks players and throughout the NBA that played in Oshkosh for $6 a ticket or whatever versus, you know, two years down the road, what's going to cost to see those guys play? We got it really good for the sports fans around here.
Well, I tell you, it's kind of ironic. Alabama, we ran arena that was a professional hockey team. So I spent 3-4 years learning how to lay ice and put ice in and learn all about hockey. And then I come here and now I'm learning basketball. So, I could tell you that Steve Brandis and the Herd and the, you know, his crew and the team have been just amazing, and they've been amazing to work with. They're very professional. I just love their program and everything that they do. You know, it's going to be a good season.
Awesome.
Yeah. The other thing besides using that, you talked about some other venues, but that size of 5,000, you know, 4,000 to 6,000, that's a good place to be for some pretty good concerts, because you're kind of catching them on their way up. You know?
Yeah.
Right. Cause
that size building, you're either catching them on their way up or catching them on their way down.
Exactly. So, that's kind of what I'm saying. I wanted to be more positive though. That's why I said that.
Classic revival band.
Right.
Which I love. I'll be honest with you.
Believe it or not though, in the market nowadays, a lot of people are wanting to play the more 5,000 to 6,000 seat arenas because they're easy to fill. And,
right.
You know, you can do sellouts, and then they don't care to come and do 2 or 3 shows, yeah. You know, on a weekend. So
nothing like being sold out. You're right.
It's easier to manage a smaller show like that. And I think that we're definitely VenueWorks Presents is one of our company, is our promoter in our company, one of our divisions. They're working hard to get some shows in here and, you know, route some shows in here. So, you know, that's one of the good things about VenueWorks that I like is that, you know, I have corporate support in any area of the building that we need, whether it's operations, food and beverage, booking shows, they're all there. So,
Todd's got a question here.
Well, I just wanted to say, Maria and Andy, as somebody who lives in Oshkosh and who enjoys the Herd, we were all very afraid that we were going to end up losing the team down the road because of some of the management that was going on. So when you guys came in, everybody kind of had a little bit of a sigh of relief, thinking this could be long term for us, whatever. And we weren't going to lose that in our own hometown, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. One thing I wanted to mention is obviously we've got that corporate support and Andy coming in, having had the experience with VenueWorks, but our leadership team, we're from here. I grew up in Winneconne. I spent some time in Milwaukee for school and then came back to the area. I live in Oshkosh, and the rest of our staff is from here, lives here. So you're going to have that continued hometown team, you know, people that know the area. We have connections to other individuals in the area that are, you know, in our ear telling us, hey, go over here and get this person to do this, you know. And so that part is really exciting as well. So the perfect combination of having that corporate background and also the local staffing.
Any hints on future acts outside of basketball coming to the arena?
Well, I can tell you we got an arm wrestling tournament coming. We got the dartball. What is it? The Wisconsin Dartball Championship coming.
Oh,
too.
Yeah, that's big. That is. And,
that's crazy popular.
As far as concerts, I can't really mention, but I've got a bunch of, I can't give names, but I do have a bunch of about six or seven on hold that we're trying to get to come through here.
Well, so, and concerts?
For one-offs, yeah.
Oh, man.
And that's cool because you got these other venues. You can test them, see what worked there, and you can offer them another place to play. Yeah, that's, you've got a lot going for you. I'm sure you're going to bring in some talent they couldn't have got alone.
Can Jim and John come down and do like a arm wrestling? A celebrity arm wrestling thing?
No,
maybe? I'm in.
No, it's,
I'm in.
What do you do with the other 5,999 seats?
Freshman year at Negaunee High School, I won the arm wrestling championship. Yeah, freshman right. year.
Yeah. Let's play a chess tournament. That'd be just as exciting.
Just saying. All right. Well, hey, you folks, we're going to be coming down at least once a month, right, Todd?
Yeah, we got to get down there. This is great what you're doing.
We'd love to come down some morning when you got some venue taking place on it, even a herd game or something, and get some players or coaches or whomever. We love Oshkosh. We love everything you guys are doing down there. So impressive. WISS is awesome.
Yeah, and really, Linton, welcome. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you made the move here because this is going to be great for Northeast Wisconsin.
Was that hockey team in Birmingham?
Yes. Birmingham Bulls.
How in the world did hockey get to Alabama?
Well, it's hot outside.
So Alabama? Birmingham's higher tech than you think, too. That, you guys got your gig is up. Wasn't that your big slogan there? That was a while ago. Yeah, you guys know what you're doing down there. But we're glad you're up here.
Thank you so much for joining us. We want you guys on a regular basis. We'll be down to Oshkosh. But just light up the signs so we don't get lost.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Hey, welcome back. Mind on the Mayor here on a Thursday. I know people always say this, but this week is like kind of flying. Maybe because of the election thing and whatever.
Right.
Okay, I'm going to ask you something. And we did talk politics yesterday, or did you talk whatever.
A little bit.
What have you, just as, and again, this is your thing. You sit back, you watch, you listen, you read, yada, yada, yada. Just give me your pulse. Give me the what you sense over these last couple of days, now that the dust has settled.
Yeah, I don't know if the dust has settled yet. It's interesting because people call and they text, and you know, I've got kids like you do, and it's like, Dad, what do you think? You know, and because some people do not like the incoming president, and I tell people you have to find something that you like. You have to. You got to look hard. Look, I've
for your own mental
exactly
sanity.
Do you really want to go through? Do you really want to go through 4 years of not liking something that you have to? That's not going to go away. It's not like, well, I'm going to go. You're not going to move out of the country, although you always have that option, and. I was reading his platform a little bit more this morning because I got talking to someone this afternoon. And, you know, you look what he's doing with education, with energy, with trade. If you read through that, there might be like, wait a minute, that's not a bad idea. You know, although there's some things that people don't like. But I think you have to look pretty hard. And
to be the devil's advocate or whatever, with reason, there are things to not like.
Oh, man. Yeah, there's a lot. But, you know, like I told, you know, my family has a little history of alcoholism, and Trump does not drink. He does not touch alcohol. And the reason he doesn't drink is because he's had friends like I've had that have really, alcohol is ruined their lives. Okay, that's kind of good. I mean, it's not, you don't have to vote for him.
Right.
But it's like, at least there's something there. But does he have any redeeming values? I think, and some people think he's obviously the majority of the country. liked him. He's going to win the popular vote. I mean, it's not.
Didn't he already? I thought it was 51-47 or something.
Okay, I don't know that. Okay. You know, that means more people voted him than not. So, and I thought Kamala was a good candidate. I did. I enjoyed watching her and listening to her.
Let me ask you this. And I've been reading a bunch of that too, and I am not a political guy like the way you are and whatever, but just for an eye for reason as a, you know, standing on the sidelines type thing. If it had been, a lot of people are blaming Joe Biden.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. You know what I'm saying, right?
Yeah.
That he didn't back out earlier. That his, and the things I keep reading, I'm just relating this, that his wife was the reason he didn't, that people saw it early on, but didn't want to cross that line. Would that have made a difference?
What she was tasked with doing, I mean, think about that, John. Because she was not the most popular, and I don't mean popular in terms of, but she wasn't the most present vice president. She didn't come here a lot. You didn't hear about a lot of stuff she was working on. And, you know, I think she was loyal, but, and for her, for, how was it, 100 and some days to really go and tell 300 million people about yourself? And that's hard to do. And that was a lot to do in 3 months or 3.5 months.
You know, in some ways, she might have been the most low-key vice president I've ever seen.
Yeah. I mean, not even. You know, like you talk about who you name as the vice president, you know, Bush and Quayle more because he was Quayle. But she just wasn't that well known. And I don't know why she took such a back seat. And maybe she did a lot and wasn't covered in the press or something. But that was a lot for her to do. I thought she did a great job. I think she traveled really well. I think she was in Wisconsin, seven times or something?
Incredible.
You know? I thought you were going to say some people thought Biden shouldn't have dropped out.
No. I'm not saying that. That's not the real. I mean, I'm not making personal opinions. I have never said a political thing in my lifetime on the air, which way I go or anything like that. Yeah. I'm just talking about the reading things where it's like insiders knew Biden
wasn't going to make it, right?
And it should have been a lot earlier, but nobody wanted to push it.
I mean, Trump's been running for 9 years. Yeah. I mean, think about that. I mean, he ran when he won and then he didn't win and he kept, you know. He was visible. He's more visible than Kamala.
Although I got to say something funny. I think it was Saturday Night Live or one of the shows. They said, who is this person? And they said, nobody will ever know this very prominent person. Who was Hillary Clinton's vice president candidate? Exactly.
Wow.
It's the most anonymous person in political history. Hillary Clinton's vice president.
If anybody would remember, it'd be that man right
there. That's what I mean.
Yeah, right? I don't remember that.
Isn't that something?
It wasn't that general. That colonel.
No,
that guy.
No, this. I don't even know what his background was. Now that I think of it,
isn't that something though? When you think about that, yeah.
Okay. Wow, that's weird.
Yeah.
I'm usually pretty good at that.
I don't remember.
So I don't remember who played the Chiefs in the Super Bowl. You go with the winner.
But anyway, I just want to get that out.
Tim Kaine, somebody just
texted. Tim Kaine. Tim Kaine, who just won.
Thanks, Sparky.
Yes, he just won his reelection. So
all right.
Back in the Senate.
But isn't that funny how some
Tim Kaine,
people just get like oblivious, you know. I was up for the, possibly, I was one heart attack away from being leader of the free world.
Right,
nobody knows who I am.
And I think that same question could be posed in a couple of years of.
I don't think so. Tim Walz?
You think people can remember him?
I do. Especially in the Midwest. He was
I'm going to be honest with you. I think that debate was a terrible thing for him and for that campaign. Don't you?
Well, yeah. Debates are risky.
I know. And he seems like such a likable guy.
Oh, man.
That's why football coach. Yeah. I'd love to love him.
I think they brought him in to shore up the blue wall. And, you know, because everybody's like, why would she pick somebody where it's a guaranteed win, right? I mean, she was going to win Minnesota.
Yeah.
And it's like he was more the Midwest than he was just Minnesota.
Okay, let me ask you this.
It didn't work if that was the reason.
Let me ask you this.
All right.
If you were running for like a big office, I mean, besides the mayor, would you ask me to be your.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
what?
God.
It's just a question. A lot of people have asked me this.
Yeah, we're out of time.
They really have.
I got so many texts, people saying that. Yeah.
If the mayor runs for president.
Would he ask you to be his running mate?
Jim, now you have the chance to answer.
No, we're out of time. Thanks for listening, everybody.
We got 20 seconds.
Mino the mayor. Yeah.
We got plenty of time.
Yeah, just have a great day. Drive safe. I'm trying to look for ways to kind of keep it going.
All right. Back again tomorrow. Out of the red, out of the blue.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.